Hello, and today we are with Mr. Rajan Datar, who is the presenter of BBC World News Fast Track travel program. Now, Mr. Datar, the first question I really have to ask you, obviously presenting such an important travel program, is how often do you travel?
Well, I've worked it out. I think on average it's about once a month. Now, I'm talking over a period of now 20 years of both doing travel programs, but also news and current affairs programs, which also involve travel. And then I have a certain sideline, which is being in a band, and we have traveled the world as well. So I think if you average it all out, it's about once a month, which may not sound too much, but then again, if you think about it, on average, if it's a week away from home every month, all year round, it adds up. I know a lot of business travellers particularly get frustrated by the stringent measures that they see, and perhaps unnecessary measures that they see applied to them at big airports like Heathrow, for instance, and around the world. And I know there's an annoyance about the inconsistency between different airports. I've got to be honest, I think ultimately it's okay to go through a very rigorous examination on departure. As long as it's not about waiting for ages in a queue, I don't mind. As long as you have enough staff, enough equipment, I don't mind how rigorous the test is, it's just waiting. And that's what I think frustrates everybody. There are certain rules, take your laptop out, your bag. I've got liquids. I mean, I think even the liquids one now is getting perhaps a little bit redundant. I think if everyone recognises that. There's some very good equipment out there, and quite frankly, it should be able to check everything. Also, most of the time, if there are issues, the officials know beforehand who is a suspicious character. They probably know that they're going to look out for this person. There is no legislating against an individual who wants to do something dangerous. And quite frankly, they will, if that happens, it happens. I think it's testimony to humankind, in a sense, that it hardly, it just doesn't happen. So going back to your point, is it unnecessary? No, in the sense that I don't mind, going through maybe even two security controls before getting on a plane. But it's the lack of resources at that airport, if it makes you do that, in making you wait for that moment. Keep it smooth. Keep the whole process smooth. Perhaps get less concerned about shopping opportunities and more concerned about making sure those queues are shorter. That's what frustrates everybody. It's waiting.
Right.
It's not security so much. It's waiting.
In America, for example, they're now piloting the TSA's trial pre-approved scheme. Do you think that's something that should be possibly spread around to places such as London Heathrow and the rest of the airports, such as Singapore or here in Bangkok? Is that something that you'd like to see happen?
It's a good question. I'll put it this way, I'm Asian, and when the first kind of big situations happened, for instance 9/11, I was singled out more, and I would possibly call that profiling, and that is not necessarily a good thing. So, having a pre-approved list suggests to me a certain element of, well, actually, certain people are okay and certain people aren't. And I presume that partly based on frequent travel and people who are business travellers and whatever else, that they allow that. But I would hate it to be discriminatory. I'd hate to think that, somebody would not get that status merely because of other factors that make them suspicious because of profiling reasons. It goes back to my original point, there'd be no need for this if the whole process was just much quicker. If resources were better, there were more staff there, and they just handled it better. You wouldn't need it. I remember my first start traveling, the airport that stood out was Singapore, because I remember that there's a swimming pool at Singapore, I don't know if it's still there. And that was astonishing, and we, the people I were with made the most of it. First opened my eyes up to the idea that actually when you're in an airport, it needn't be a huge boring ordeal. There are things to do, and when an airport does that, when it provides extra facilities, now again, you've now got TVs in many more airports than you ever used to. I can see that making a difference already. People can watch television, live television. The Olympics was on recently while I was at the airport. Everybody glued to the Olympics. It makes an awful lot of difference. You mentioned the Virgin Lounge. I've only been lucky enough to go to that a few times, because we don't actually go anything more than economy most of the time. And yes, fantastic. You get a haircut. I had it when I first had a haircut in Laos. I had a massage. All great. But when it comes down to it, newspapers, some decent food. You know, the whole. What's happening more and more now is that people are paying for the extra privilege of going into a lounge without necessarily being members. So you can pay for that service, just like everything. You know, it's called unbundling, isn't it? Whereby you pay for every single detail of your journey. So that all your, the bare minimum is just you get on the flight and then you get to the other side. If you want to pay for the extras, I can see why the airlines do that. Ancillaries, that's not a bad thing. But I think it should be open to everybody, and they should be able to decide what they want. Do you have a menu almost before you get to the airport? What do I want to do? This, and this on my journey. So in between security and getting on the plane. Yes, give everyone. Make it a service, not, as I say, an ordeal. I think if you change the mindset at an airport like that, customers will be far more well-mannered, happy, and look forward to travel again. Because when I was a kid, it was the most exciting thing going. How come it's become a pain in the neck? It shouldn't be. It should be exciting.
Right. Now, you mentioned the ancillary revenues. Airlines are trying to, for example, find revenue in as many different streams as they can. A lot of frequent travellers, especially those possibly that are travelling on business, say to me they would pay extra to be on a child-free flight. Now, this is quite a controversial, and I know you have a family. So what are your thoughts on this? Is this something, if you're like an airline like Singapore Airlines, which has got numerous flights a day to somewhere like London Heathrow, they have the frequency. Do you think it's something that an airline should be trying to possibly?
Strange question that, because guess what? Before I had children, I would have been on the side of those people who wanted child-free flights. Now, I've got an awful lot of sympathy for parents with kids. I mean, it's tough for kids flying, really, especially young kids. Even down to the earache that a kid will get, it's not good. I do understand if you are a frequent traveller, you've got some work to do, and right next to you is a screaming child. Possibly, I think some airlines might do this, separating families from individual passengers who perhaps need to do some work. Now, those individual passengers may not be able to afford business class, so I don't think they should be discriminated against in that sense and be just lumped in with everybody else. If you want to make that choice, I suspect it's not a bad thing to have a separate area in a plane, but to have whole child-free planes, that would then restrict the choice of the family who want to go to wherever and need to go on that 10 o'clock flight in the morning, and guess what, they can't go because it's a child-free flight. I don't know how good an idea that is, and what's next after that? Who else cannot be allowed to be on certain flights?
Rather discriminatory.
I must admit, clearly my view has changed with having children. And why don't some passengers just go, it's great having kids on a plane. Look at what they add to the situation, apart from the crime. Look what they add, not how they spoil my journey.
Yeah, well, it's definitely interesting to think what they will be flying in 20 or 30 years' time when they are in a situation similar to yourself or myself. What they will be actually flying in, whether they'll be going straight up and straight down Australia to London in 10 minutes or so, who knows?
That'd be fantastic.
In terms of technology, obviously, a lot of hotels are targeting somebody like yourself. You travel frequently, you're tech savvy. What technology do you like to see in hotels? Because a lot of hotels are still experimenting with technology. For example, self-service kiosks. Some hotels don't believe it's five-star. You have 24-hour stays where you can check in at 6 o'clock and check out at 6. What do you personally like to see at the moment, and what would you like to see as we move forward?
Self-service kiosks, I think, great, fantastic. And if you've got the option, brilliant. I mean, I was talking yesterday about when you arrive at a hotel, sometimes because of the desire to give a quality, high-quality service, it actually delays your going into your room and just flopping out if you want to do that. Because the first thing you want to do after a long journey is get straight to the room. You do not want to be hanging around, waiting for luggage, waiting in a queue to get served. Maybe have the choice. If you want personal service, fine, have that. If you want to do it by yourself in a kiosk, fantastic. In terms of what I definitely need in terms of technology, that I'm still surprised is not universal, is Wi-Fi. It's got to be free Wi-Fi throughout the hotel, and that Wi-Fi has got to work. You know, it's incredible how often you'll be told it's free Wi-Fi, and when you get into a room, it doesn't work. So that is pretty simple. I know how little it costs a hotel, so forget trying to make money out of that. That's what I would definitely say. And you know what? It's also little simple things like, and this isn't technology, this is tea and coffee and milk in a room for free. You know, it's not asking too much. When someone's paying for all that and they want to just be in their room and do that, have that service. Again, you'd be surprised how many hotels don't have that. That isn't even technology. You know, that's what I find bizarre. Well, how they could help is finding your flight details out from you, making it easy for you to know before you leave if your flight's delayed, how to get to the airport, all that stuff. The first thing the passenger will think is, if I book through you, will I be paying some sort of huge premium price for this cab? Well, I can get a cab by myself out in the street for probably cheaper. Allay their fears. A customer will love you, will absolutely love you, and give you their loyalty if they think you are, without looking to make money, providing a good service for them. And that applies to Wi-Fi, it applies to the whole notion of perhaps before you leave, knowing what you want, what newspaper you want, what kind of breakfast you might want, and where, perhaps even telling me, where is the breakfast floor, where is the, because the kind of things you forget, if you want an alarm call. Ask me, email me beforehand, just ask me. If I've got time, and I might well have time, I'll go this, and this. Fantastic. Right. Sorted.
Now you mentioned there, for example, you mentioned tea and coffee. Well, a very basic thing, but it's amazing that a lot of hotels still don't do that. Mm. Thankfully, here in Asia Pacific, I'd say a lot of them have caught on to that now. But what is interesting is if you were to go to the UK, a hotel chain such as Premier Inn, for example, they have tea and coffee standard throughout all of their hotels at very reasonable rates. They also, strangely enough, because they are in the UK and you don't necessarily think of the sun when you think of the UK, they have solar power now coming into some of their hotels, which is not something that we have yet seen. I'd like to ask you, of all of the hotels you've seen all over the world, which would you say is the greenest aspect? You don't necessarily need to name the hotel, but which would be the greenest type of property that you've seen?
I'd say what it isn't. It isn't towels, put them on your bed if you don't need them to be washed, because I know, having talked to experts, that doesn't actually make much difference. It is about, actually, it's behind the scenes, it's recycling, it's stuff you don't necessarily see as a customer. I once did a piece at a major London hotel. They were very proud of what they were doing in terms of green measures, but they were like gestures essentially. And the green expert I was with was saying, look, this isn't working. They are actually wasting much more energy in doing this than otherwise. So in terms of where I've been, they tend to be quite interesting independent boutique hotels. There was one in Shanghai, I think in China, that was part of a boutique group that was very, very good on this. And you'd be surprised where they crop up. But if they're part of the idea behind the hotel in the first place, so the whole building has been built around that premise, that's when I think you get the most effective results. I think as customers, there was a whole phase, a whole fad of, oh, is it green? You know, make sure, ask these questions, do this. To me, the most important thing fundamentally is that they source from the local economy. They use local people and they source their food and everything they need from local people. You'd be surprised how many miles are used up, food miles or whatever else, from importing food that they think their customers want. I think the customers, if they knew they were local, locally sourced, except for perhaps certain things, would be very happy with that. That is what causes the most waste.
Right.
Or the lack of that, rather. Yeah.
Right. Of course, some hotels will say it helps to differentiate themselves. A five-star hotel will say, well, if we import our lamb from New Zealand or this, that, the other. Coming to that side of the hotel industry, there was a time when a five-star hotel was very clear. It had this. A four-star had that, and a three-star had this. Do you feel that there is now a blurring? Do you feel that the star system has it already died, or do you think it no longer means what it used to?
The star system, I've done a piece about this, is virtually meaningless. Within a country, certain countries, it can make sense. That relies on inspections, that relies on not necessarily box ticking, because that's what STARS system comes down about. Is there an elevator? Is there a TV in the room? Is there a swimming pool? That can change your STARS status. From country to country, it differs. In certain countries, now in France, for instance, you've got an extra new super five-star level, which is now adding an extra layer of complexity to the whole thing. Personally, I think also because of the internet, because of travel advisory sites, TripAdvisor, those things, people are now actually giving the ultimate judgment about what is a good hotel and not. That is what people now read. The problem then, of course, as we know, is how that system of customer response can be manipulated and abused. But I think they're getting better on that, and I think ultimately that is how people will judge a hotel. Yes, you can use, if you need a rough star system, fine, use it, but people don't believe it anymore. And what's a 3-star in one country, Ukraine, for instance, I've been there recently, would be a 1-star in another country, and the other way around.
Right. Now, of course, service is one way to measure this. Now, you and I both have been to some of the best hotels in the world, and if your experience is anything like my experience, I think viewers will be quite surprised by this. You've stayed in some of the best properties, some middle properties, and possibly some of the worst properties, I'd imagine. Of all the hotels that you've ever stayed in, how many of them send you a birthday card that you remember every single year?
The answer is none. When it comes to my age, I'm not too unhappy about that, because to be reminded yet again how old I am, sometimes not. But I do know it, absolutely. That sense of personal service is brilliant. If a hotel can capture that without being intrusive, that is really good. If they can remember certain aspects of what you like, those hotels that actually provide you with the right, with a pillow that they know you love. Again, that tends to be a service only provided to the premium elite customers. It should be for everybody. I don't think it costs very much to do that. And I think the rewards they would reap from that would be immense, loyalty in particular. So birthdays, I can honestly say not one hotel has ever emailed me and said happy birthday.
That's quite amazing.
But then there are members of my family who are just as bad. You know, so.
They're not looking for you on mail. We should know that. And finally, we are in Thailand at the moment. So for my final question, I would like to ask you, do come here frequently. When you are here, do you have a favourite dish? It's a favourite Thai food that you must have when you're here?
To be honest, I don't come here that frequently. This is actually only my second time. I'm a bit of a Thai food fan back in Britain, but I don't eat meat, which slightly limits the range. But I've got to be honest with you, it's going to sound very British, but I'm a Pad Thai fan. I love fish cakes, Thai fish cakes, and the soups that they have. The fish soups here are fantastic. Anything, quite frankly, that's cooked by a Thai chef or anyone is going to be good, because they love spicy food, and there's something about the delicacy, the size of the food that you deal with. It's right up my street. It's exactly what I love. I hate huge mounds on plates. I hate bulk. So if there's anything that's going to put you off eating, it's a bulky plate, and Thailand is very good at that. It doesn't do that for you, and it's always going to be one of Thailand's strengths, its food. Its cuisine is superb. I've never had a bad Thai meal.
Well, that's great to hear. And it is almost lunchtime, and what you've just said just has made me very, very hungry. So I have to say thank you very much for your time today, Mr. Datar, and of course the best of luck in the future, and to the BBC, and safe travels.
Stephen, thank you very much indeed. Pleasure.